last Sunday, I went to PS1, Contemporary Art Center in New York, with my wife and daughter, and there I came across this work in the galleries. It's a work called Model for Seating for Eight. It's by the artist Scott Burton. It was made in 1985. I was really excited to see it. Scott Burton lived and worked in New York in the 1970s and 1980s. I also live and work in New York. I've lived in New York since 1993 is when I moved there. I'm a graphic designer by training and by identification. I don't have a very conventional practice, which maybe you'll get a sense of as I show you some work over the past number of years. Well, Scott Burton began his career as a playwright and an art critic. He was writing around in the late 1960s. He wrote some important art historical texts, including the main essay for the exhibition Live in Your Head, When Attitudes Become Form, from 1968, which was organized in Bern, Switzerland. Soon after that, after beginning as a writer and a playwright, Burton started making his own artwork. First, these were performances. Increasingly, he added furniture to the performances, and by the late 1970s, he was working just with furniture. Most of the furniture looked like the one in this model, so let me just show you a little bit. So this is a model for a larger work that he made. The larger work is just the thing that the person is sitting on. It's not the person as well. This is really a maquette. So most of the furniture looked like the one in this model. Simple, almost ridiculously geometric forms made of marble and terrazzo and aluminum. Burton insisted that he wasn't simply designing furniture, but rather that he was making artworks. He even came up with a new category for the work. He called these things pragmatic sculptures. These sculptures were meant to be used. They're shown in museums, held in private collections, but they're also installed as public artworks. Seating for Eight, for example, this, which is the model for that work, is in a public park in Des Moines, Iowa, in the U.S. The sculptures there, they look like a public artwork. They're meant to be looked at, but they're also meant to be sat on. And even in the galleries, when they're shown, these works are meant to be sat on as well as seen. And I think it's that kind of, I like them for that reason. They have a charged dynamic to them. You don't know whether to use them or to look at them or what exactly you're supposed to do with them. You know, are they pieces of sculpture? Are they pieces of furniture? The closest answer I can imagine is that they're kind of either one or both, maybe, or either and both, I think. I was struck by this work last Sunday because it seemed to be a perfect model for thinking about something, about a word I've been using a lot recently to talk about my own design work. And that word is interface. Pretty generic, big, baggy word. Means a lot of things. Interfaces, of course, surround us. We use them all the time as we stare into our phones, as we work on our computers. It occurs to me that it makes sense to come to terms with these things that we spend so much time dealing with. Just for example, you see the media that sprung up last week around Twitter changing the interface for marking a tweet as something that you approve of. Before, they marked it with a star and it was called a favorite. You could favorite a tweet. And then it got changed to a heart. And so there from now on, and it's called like, and so you can like a tweet. And you know, the insular, well, maybe not insular, but the world of Twitter was up in arms about the fact that this interface changed from star to heart and how that affected the action, the perceived action of what you do with that thing. And people hated the fact that you had to, you could, favoriting something was just simply different than liking it, and starring it was different than hearting it. And so it made a big difference. Interface is an elastic word, like I said. It's used in many different fields. It's used in chemistry, theater, fashion, computer science, all have slightly different definitions of it, which include a shared boundary, a contact surface, a border condition, a process or active threshold. But what I think is important is that an interface is a thing in itself. It's not only something that works and that you use to get something done, but it also transmits or can transmit a point of view. I want you to think about this, imagine this, if you will, with me, that this artwork or this model for an artwork is an interface. It's an interface between a person and the earth, maybe, or between a person, the act of sitting, I'm not quite sure. But typically we think of works of art and works of design as having they're principally representations or pictures. They're pictures to think about the world with. But these sculptures are something else. They're not mirrors of the world, but they're more a kind of hinge, a connection, a bonding agent or glue, something like this. So instead of representations, they offer a kind of working proposition. The world could be like this if it was like this. There's the back of that hinge. This is also a book I've been looking at a lot recently. This is a book from 1987. Its title is there in the middle, Design Interface. It's by an Italian philosopher and newspaper writer named Gianni Barbicetto. This book details a very mundane graphic design project, but explodes out the details of that into essentially the history of all communication. I mean, it's kind of wonderfully broad and expansive in its scope. I love that about it. So the contained design problem that this book is dealing with is the design of an interface at the Olivetti Corporation for photocopiers and faxes, which were appearing when this book was made in 1987. So these relatively new office machines had new functions, and they needed a new kind of graphic language and design for how to use these things, how a user might make sense of these. On the cover is a detail of one of those interfaces. But on the first page, when you open it, across from Barbicetto's introductory essay is another interface. It's the Rosetta Stone. Okay, so you go from this, like photocopier interface, to Rosetta Stone, and they're both the same thing in this kind of, in this worldview. So he sets this up and he says, well, this is also, the Rosetta Stone's also an interface. And then he gives a little bit better definition of interface, which I'll stick with from now on, which he says, whatever lies between is called interface. Whatever allows us to link two different elements, to reconcile them, to put them into communication. So the Rosetta Stone, which of course has three different languages on its surface and allows translation from one language to the other, puts these various cultures and writing systems and glyphs into communication with each other. So this is the way that he describes it as an interface. This is the more mundane design project the book is actually detailing. And this is the set of symbols and kind of graphic language that goes on the photocopier interface. And these are pictures of the interfaces, of those interfaces themselves. This is all the introduction. These are two more Scott Burton chairs. These were in an exhibition that I saw in the spring that was at the Bard Hessel Museum, upstate New York. These two chairs appeared in an exhibition that also has the same title that I borrowed for this talk. The name of that exhibition was I'll Be Your Interface. And these chairs sit there. And actually, if you look closely on one of the chairs, Barbicetto's book is sitting there. And that's because I put it there, but it is there. It was actually part of the exhibition, was the book on the chair. So. So this, everything I'm going to show tonight, this is important. Everything I'm going to show tonight is work that I do together with a partner who is not here right now. His name is Stuart Bailey. Stuart lives in Liverpool currently. We've worked together since 2006. Stuart is also a graphic designer. Together we work under a shared name, which is Dexter Sinister, which Federico mentioned in the introduction. We're both trained as graphic designers, identify as graphic designers, but increasingly our work ends up in art contexts, maybe more than graphic design, typical graphic design commissions, or sometimes places in between, which is what's the most interesting to us, I suppose. These chairs were in an exhibition that that was of our work and we helped organize that was up at Bard this spring. It mixed some Dexter Sinister projects with existing works from the collection. It was organized with curator Roxana Fabius there. Here's a picture of that, and here's the title graphics that you see here. That work on the floor is something that Stuart and I made. I'll talk about that in just a moment. Many of the other works in the show are obviously things we did not make, like the Dan Flavin sculpture, which is on the right-hand wall there, or the Scott Burton chairs to the left. Would have liked to make those. Okay. So increasingly, I was suggesting our work appears more in art exhibitions, not necessarily in exhibitions of our work, but alongside other works, or sometimes in a supporting role to exhibitions, making catalogs and doing this kinds of things, but a lot of times in gray areas. So I thought it was quite nice for Federico to invite me here today, since Second Thoughts is dealing with a kind of different kind of graphic design practice that Federico's identified, which treats graphic design as both a kind of medium for working in and also a subject matter. So sometimes the works like reflect back on graphic design in some way. Sometimes they just use the tech tools and techniques of graphic design. Sometimes they work as traditional graphic design for a client. Sometimes they work in a freer manner. You'll see a bunch of things which work in different ways. Okay. So, Dexter Sinister is a few different things. Principally, these days, it is a shared name that Stuart Bailey and I work together under. Dexter Sinister is also a space in New York City on the Lower East Side on Ludlow Street. It's a very small basement with low ceilings. It was set up in 2006 by Stuart and I when he was at that point living in New York. When we originally established Dexter Sinister, the space, we called it two things. We said it was a just-in-time workshop and occasional bookstore. So that worked like this. We were already both working quite extensively as graphic designers on catalogs and books and other things in the art world, websites and so forth. And we increasingly got frustrated with the kind of amount of waste that were involved in the projects that we were dealing with and wanted to take a bit more control over the work that we did and not have the decisions delegate, you know, handed down to us, but think about things from the ground up and kind of from the perspective of what a graphic designer might know about the production of materials. So, for example, catalogs always have some clever way to deal with not having exhibition images because the catalog must come out on the day that the show opens. And so we reconsidered that from the, you know, we did a series of projects where we just simply kind of reconsidered that, and that, whether that was issuing a catalog as a series of pamphlets that came out over time or just reconsidering these things from a little bit lower level. We situated that under the name Just In Time Workshop, and it was a kind of both critique and strange embrace, something between the two, really, or both, of a post-Fordist model of working where you don't need, where your practice is much more flexible and doesn't rely on many supporting mechanisms. The second, when we launched the Just-in-Time Workshop, we made this invitation for our opening party there, and it employed the rhetoric of manufacturing to talk about graphic design. It was a bit absurd, but it was typical of the kinds of things that we continue to do, which is to both make design work, but also write about it and publish about it and kind of set a context for how it can be received in the world, rather than simply have it read as a service to a client, although often it's that as well. So it's something else. These were the business cards that we made for the Just in Time workshop and occasional bookstore, and I think these kind of communicate more than anything else. And perhaps just the so these we made four different business cards. The first one is borrows a quote from Benjamin Franklin and says, "Keep thy shop, and thy shop will keep thee." So this space was both a studio, a workshop, and it was also a bookstore, one day a week bookstore, where we were selling the publications that we were involved in publishing or designing or writing in, and we are often in more than one capacity. So we like the idea that this could be both a place of selling things and of making things. It started out as kind of a joke to make it a bookstore. I mean, it's in a really shoddy basement, which used to be for food storage in a not a very nice store. Not a very convincing retail space in Manhattan, but nonetheless, if you announce it a bookstore, people will come and they buy books. So it works. So keep thy shop and thy shop will keep thee. The second card is a series of random digits from a book called A Million Random Digits. So that's the second card. The third card is a quote by Stuart Brand, who is an American editor and writer and kind of impresario of sorts, made the Whole Earth catalog. He coined this phrase, which you've heard before, information wants to be free. But you never hear the second part, which is information also wants to be expensive. Information wants to be free because it's been cheap to distribute, copy and recombine, too cheap to meter. It wants to be expensive because it can be immeasurably valuable to the recipient. Okay, so that's the third card. And the fourth card is a quote from Jean-Luc Godard, French filmmaker. That's not even a full sentence, so we put a period at the end. The children of Marx and Coca-Cola. That's who we pledge allegiance to, I suppose. Actually, I'll leave it back on this. So, Dexter Sinister was set up in 2006. We ran it as a bookstore, as a proper bookstore, open one day a week for 5 years. And then since then, we've had it open by appointment, and it functions less actively as a bookstore and more effectively as a studio. Stuart, in the meantime, now lives in England. He lived in Los Angeles between, but anyway. So Dexter Sinister has branched out. We've kind of pragmatically branched out, depending on what the invitations were, into doing lots of other things that aren't what we started out doing. And many of these are art exhibitions, participating in them or doing something around them. And I find now that's the majority of the work that I do. So just at this moment, as I'm speaking, there's an exhibition, a survey exhibition of work that Stuart and I have made under the name Dexter Sinister since 2006 that's open in Munich at the Kunstverein München. Exhibition venue in Munich. The name of that show is Dexter Sinister on a Universal Cereal Bus. Since I'm kind of struggling to make sense of what this show or the work in it means, so I thought it might be nice to talk about that, because also that will incorporate a lot of the work that's happened in the meantime. So since we can't all, you know, get in a bus and go to Munich right now, it'd be a pretty bad idea. Then what I thought we would do is I wanted to show you parts of that exhibition through a video walkthrough, and then I'll break out from that walkthrough and talk about the pieces as we get to them. That video walkthrough is a pretty funny thing in and of itself. It was made by the director of the Kunstverein named Chris Fitzpatrick, and Chris made the walkthrough on his iPhone using slow-mo video. And a Steadicam, which just keeps it like a thing that attaches to the phone and makes it so that it looks smooth as you walk through. So this is we're not going to watch the whole video. It's an hour and 24 minutes and not exactly scintillating. But what I want to do is use that as a kind of interface of sorts to talk through the work that's contained in it. So, as I say, be a bit of an experiment. When you walk in, you're greeted by this moving asterisk at the top of the stairs. That moving asterisk speaks the introductory text, what would usually be done as a wall text in vinyl in an exhibition. In this case, it's a work that by Dexter Sinister that we made that utilizes a speaking asterisk to read the introduction to the show. This is something that we've been working on over the past year in several different contexts, so I want to talk about a couple of different places where this has existed before. The first place we used it was in that exhibition that I first showed you called I'll Be Your Interface, and I'm going to play a little excerpt from that. The speaking asterisk also read a text that introduced you to the show, so play that.
I'll be your interface. Asterisk. There are magic words that emerge in the use of language and then succeed in imposing themselves on the mind. These are key slash words, which seem to take the full risk of merging in a single term all the lines of force, complex intuitions, shifting concepts, and developing debates, incurring the danger that all of this wealth of notions, still volatile and unstable, be reduced to a simple and closed verbal expression, that it be mortified, trivialized, or used as a skeleton key to open doors of all sorts. It is inevitable. One of the properties of language is that it lays traps into which we fall all too often.
Okay. That was the first version. That was in March. The next place we use this, and we often find ourselves doing this, making things that appear as pieces of design or go into exhibitions and make no distinction between the two particularly. We worked with the nonprofit art space in Athens, which is called Radio at 10. And Radio at 10, we made a version of the asterisk, which became their logo. Radio at 10 is a small space. This is a picture of the office, but it happened to have a light on the wall. It looked like an asterisk, so that was nice. It's just a coincidence. We made the asterisk as a speaking logo because they called themselves Radio at 10. And the speaking asterisk appears on their website and announces all the projects that they're doing, both in their space and elsewhere throughout the city. The director is somebody we had worked with before when she was in Berlin. I'm going to play a little excerpt of the asterisk from Radio at 10.
Broadcasting from the ether, somewhere in and around the center of Athens, Greece. Near the end of Petraki Street, this is Radio at 10. Radio at 10 is a bookstore. Radio at 10 is a showroom. Radio at 10 is an exhibition space. Each of these functions appear at different speeds.
Okay. The next place that we used the asterisk over the course of this year was for an exhibition in Bregenz in Austria. We were invited to make an exhibition in the ground floor lobby space of the Kunsthaus Bregenz. This is a space which they call Arena, and they typically show things that aren't quite contemporary art in this space, like architecture practices or magazines or other things. So they invited us to do something with there. This was in March and April of this year. What we decided to do was they had run a very active 5-year exhibition program in this space, and we thought we were given an open invitation, but we thought what might be good is to turn it into kind of an applied or design project. And as they had never archived these exhibitions very well, and through a conversation with the curator, we decided we would use the asterisk installed in the space to tell, in reverse chronological order, describe all the exhibitions that had existed in there, kind of to conjure them before your eyes while you sit there in front of this speaking asterisk, which is projected on the wall. She tells you about what has happened in that space before. So here's the arena space as it typically looks. We changed it a bit. We put carpet in it for the sound. We closed the curtains, although these operate on a timer, and so every 30 minutes the curtains close by themselves, the lights go down, and then this asterisk appears projected on the wall. It's the same asterisk. It's a slightly better, more developed version and a longer script. We wrote the script that she speaks, and in this case, we also designed the software that makes the thing run. I'm going to play a little excerpt from the beginning of this work, which is here.
I'll be your interface. Asterisk. Please look and listen carefully to what I say. I was spritted by Dexter Sinister, the working name of Spewer Bailey and David Reinfurt. Dexter Sinister worked somewhere in the middle of design, editing, publishing and distribution. And I am no exception. You're standing in the of the conspice red ends. Luke North. I am the moving glyph on the concrete wall. To the west is a window facing Lake Constance, which joins Austria, Switzerland, and Germany. To the east is another concrete wall. And over your shoulder, to the south, is the reception desk.
She continues on and then describes exhibitions in reverse chronological order, starting from herself and then working backwards. The last asterisk I'm going to show is the one that I just showed on the video, and that's the asterisk that appears in on a Universal serial bus in Munich right now. I want to play a slightly longer excerpt of that asterisk and let her read to you about the show to describe it. So here's the clip.
What's on a Universal serial bus? A collection of electronic works by Dexter Sinister, produced from 2008 to 2015. Dexter Sinister is the compound name of Spewer Bailey and David Reinfurt. They operate at the intersection of graphic design, publishing, and contemporary art. This memory stick, Universal serial bus, is released alongside an exhibition in 2015 at Kunstverein München.
Okay. She goes on and describes that there are four projects in the exhibition. It turns out that the Kunstverein has four rooms that are laid out one after the other, like a shoebox, kind of in serial fashion, so that worked out rather well. So there are four previous projects. Each one exists in a room. I'm going to go back to the video now and talk about the next thing. Up the video and get a little bit closer to where we want to be. When you walk upstairs, you wouldn't notice this unless you have keen eyesight, perhaps. I need to forward a little bit more. Plugged into the wall, the first wall that you see is a Universal serial bus, a USB memory stick, which is right there. The name of the exhibition is On a Universal Serial Bus. The premise of the exhibition was that this is its catalog. This is the catalog for the exhibition, and it's a publication which includes four projects by Stuart and I. It's being released by Sternberg Press in Berlin. The name of the publication is Dexter Sinister Universal Serial Bus. It includes everything. The main works that are in the exhibition are on this memory stick, and the exhibition contains the things that are on the stick. So you got to ask which one came first. Actually, the idea for the stick came first, so you don't have to ask that, but I would like to ask that. Here's a more detailed, glamorous shot of a USB stick, of the Universal Serial Bus stick, if that can be glamorous. This is the front. These were custom made, even though they don't look like they were, because the USB logo looks like this. We thought there was something rather nice about making a USB stick as a publication. It'll be sold just like a book. It's packaged with a postcard. Because USB sticks are almost out of date, and they will be soon enough. And that seemed pretty interesting or complicated or whatever. It seemed nice to do for us. The reverse side says what the name of the thing is. When you insert the memory stick in your computer, you get an icon like this. And here are the contents of the memory stick. It includes four projects. Identity, which is at the top, which is a three-screen projected video. The next thing is called True Mirror Microfiche Video. The next project actually has two pieces called Work in Progress and The Last Shot Clock. And the final piece is called Letter in Spirit. Actually, there's one more piece which is called Read Me, which is the asterisk, which describes everything that's on the stick. We just heard a little bit of that as the introduction to the exhibition. This is the postcard that goes along with the USB stick. Okay, we'll go back to the video. And we're going to speed to the first room in the exhibition, first proper room. And we'll go fast to get back there. So you're going back in the back room. Okay. And in the back room is a three-screen projection. A three-screen projection, which actually sounds nothing like this. This is only because it's slow. A three-screen projection that's called Identity. It's actually Identity in quotation marks. And this is a piece of work that Stuart and I made, commissioned by Artist Space in New York and exhibited at Artist Space in 2011. I'm going to now go back to the slides and show you what that looks like. Talk a little bit about that. So here is Identity as it was installed first at Artist Space in New York. Three screens. It's about a 20-minute piece. We imagined it kind of like a PowerPoint presentation. The subject matter of Identity is art institutions and their graphic identities and all the institutional kind of hand-wringing and worrying that goes around what a logo is, or what kind of logo is for their institution, or what they call themselves. Stuart and I are often directly involved in this, and it was good subject matter for this work. We call this piece a projection. I mean, they were rear projected. It's got three channel audio. The left screen deals with a case study the Pompidou in Paris. The middle screen deals with the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and the right screen deals with the Tate in London. All of the script that we assembled for this 20-minute long piece is taken from other people's writings, so we just edit it together. And the stories of each institution are told in reverse chronological order, all the way back to the first trademark, which appeared on a Bass beer, to the first commercial trademark, which appeared on Bass beer at the end of the 19th century. And it turns out to be a triangle. Triangle also turns out to be the logo for Artist Space. So that was a nice coincidence in all of this. I'm going to play a little excerpt of the beginning of this three-screen projection.
2010.
Oof.
Open.
That doesn't sound right.
Diverse. International. Entrepreneurial. Sustainable. Always changing, always Tate. Tate solid becomes Tate porous. Tate foreground becomes Tate background. Tate fixed size becomes Tate flexible. Branding is moving into nations, regions, cities, and what is increasingly being described as the third sector, those cultural organizations that do not exist.
Okay, I'm going to stop it there. The identity projection continues on and goes through these three case studies and arrives at this proposal, which we imagine the entire thing as a kind of presentation of a new logo to Artist Space. And we suggested to them that they replace their triangle with this new model, which we designed and we wrote, which you can read here. It says, a new symbol proposed and projected inside this space is, like every logo, all surface, a bubble, blown around nothing, inflated to bursting point by the lazy assumption that we look like, that what we look like is who we are. In other words, identity, in quotes, equals identity. Okay, now we suggested at Artist Space, and we really thought they would go for it, that they would take this logo, and this would be their logo from now on. So they would kind of, it would embed a very explicit critique into how they do their graphics. In order to make this thing, Stuart and I had to write to the format of this like graphic triangle, and we often find ourselves kind of working in this way, backwards out of the original. Artist Space did replace their logo for the run of our show, which was 2 months, and then went back to their regular triangle. In the meantime, they started putting text into that triangle, but it's not this text. So anyway, all in good. I mean, I don't know if I really expected them to do it, but who knows? Anyway, it was not critical. I think the way they were doing their graphics was quite good already. But this was more to make to talk about the worry that typically attends these things. Not to say it's good or bad necessarily, but just to point to it. Okay, we're going to keep on traveling through the show, and we're going to go out of the identity room, which is here. And we'll speed through that. You can see the different screens light up when different parts are being spoken of. Very fast. In fact, we'll move all the way out of the room, back into the second room, which we'll see here. The second room is around a project that Stuart and I did in 2008 for the Whitney Biennial in New York. The name of that project was True Mirror. It was maybe the first time, or the biggest project we'd been invited to be involved in a different capacity. And in fact, the curators came and asked us how we thought we might be able to be involved in the exhibition, and we didn't immediately know what this is. So we're going to pause it here, and we're going to look at this piece that's on the wall with more detail here. We said, well, we could design the catalog, but there didn't seem to be enough room in that assignment to do something as interesting as maybe they were suggesting we could do. We could make a parallel catalog that we edited and that would go along with the real one, but we thought that would be too easily dismissed as just kind of an artist project that was not the catalog. Or we could do something else, and so we proposed something else. What we proposed to do, what we saw as a problem with the Whitney Biennial, was that this exhibition gets a lot of attention very quickly in New York and gets reviewed almost before it gets seen. And there's a conversation that runs up around it. We thought it might be interesting to work against that and somehow slow down its reception or complicate it, put some noise into the channel around the institutional communication around the show. So we proposed to the Whitney that we would set up a temporary office for 3 weeks. It would be an information office. It would be hidden behind a wall in the exhibition, so nobody would see us, but we'd go to work there every day. And from that office, we would make press releases that went out under the name Whitney, but were not officially sanctioned by them. And that we would invite artists and writers and other curators, as it turns out, to help us make these things, to work with on these press releases. This that you saw on the wall was a letter of invitation that we kind of carefully wrote to describe this project to our collaborators. We often work with lots of people on projects. In this case, there were 42 who took our call. The letter begins, "Dear cooperators, I have taken the typewriter down from the stack of boxes in the back room in order to guarantee a certain slowness and precision here." So anyway, we typewrote this letter. We then mailed it from Dublin, Ireland, because the whole project was called True Mirror and it was around doubling, and we thought it'd be funny to send it from Dublin. So a handwritten, hand-typed letter arrived to our collaborators. We probably sent it to 60 people. 42 took the bait. It arrived from Dublin, postmarked, and said, "Will you participate in this project with us?" Many people said yes, great. The project name was True Mirror, and that was named after this commercial product, which is called True Mirror. This product is like a mirror, but it's a mirror for a mirror. So this mirror shows you like a mirror image of your mirror. It works by having two pieces of mirror glass at 45 degree angles to each other. So when you look at it, you don't see your mirror image, you see the mirror's mirror. In other words, you see how other people see you, and it's very strange to see this. This happened to be like in the restroom of a bar we went to on Ludlow Street, and we thought, wow, it's amazing. And it was made by a brother and sister small business in East Village in New York. We contacted them. They were very happy to go along with us and make us a true mirror for the show. And so the work we made in the show, aside from the press releases, was to install these mirrors in the bathrooms at the Whitney. So for the run of the biennial, we had two mirrors in the men's and the women's bathroom that were these true mirrors that showed you your mirror's reflection. We liked the idea that it was simply a commercial product that then we took and used it as a commercial product, but under the kind of umbrella of an art project, I suppose. This is a picture of the room where we were setting up our press office. Turns out the Whitney Museum used the 69th Street Armory space in New York on Park Avenue and more for their performance projects. And so we set up office in this little, there happened to be a dressing room that was hidden, and so we set up our office in there. This is an example of one of the press releases that we made for the exhibition. This was the one that we made, we actually made two of these. We made these on the opening night. And which the Whitney was absolutely cooperative with us, which was surprising. They gave us all their press contacts, all their emails. We sent these things wide and far. It was kind of amazing. This was the first press release that we made. We made this together with two writers in Los Angeles named Margaret and Catherine Wertheim. They had suggested in a New York Times editorial piece that you could make a spotlight that traveled faster than the speed of light. And they described how that would happen, and I won't describe that right now, but that was a very compelling idea to us. And so we proposed back to Whitney, we said we want to try this. We want to set up a Klieg light, like giant spotlight, in front of the Whitney Museum on the opening night of the biennial and in front of the auxiliary space, the armory, on the opening night of the biennial. That was all going forward. We couldn't believe it, or else the curators just didn't want to tell us that there's no way this is happening. But it was going forward. And then the Park Avenue Block Association canceled this light, this giant light on their prime real estate. So what we decided to do instead was make a press release that announced we'd use these just at each location, and it said there's a giant Klieg light at the other location. Go to the other location. So you go to at the armory, we announced there's a Klieg light at the Whitney. There wasn't really. At the Whitney, we announced there's a Klieg light at the armory. There wasn't really. So that's typical of the way some of these press releases worked. They kind of inserted some kind of noise into the channel. When we finished that project, we then made an archive of all of the press releases that we made, 42 in all. We made that as a microfiche, which is a photographic process that makes tiny reproductions of static documents. That went to the Whitney, and then we used that tiny, it's about this big, that small form, as a basis for a performance that we later made, which was called True Mirror Microfiche. And this performance was used many of the collaborators who worked with us in the Whitney project, and they essentially spoke or performed their press releases to a theatrical audience at the Kitchen first in New York, and then we did it a year later at the Institute for Contemporary Art in London. This is a still from the performance in New York. From the performance in London, one of the main performers, Kojo Ishwan, sent us a very nice email after the fact about what it was like to perform in this strange kind of speaking press release thing. And we ended up using his email to make a video, which appears in the show. And I'm going to show you an excerpt of that. And it covers a little bit of the performance. The text is from Kojo's email.
Because the brain has two different parts, it sends different messages from each side. These messages appear on different sides of the face, where they merge to form personality. By reversing the two sides, a typical mirror presents a vision that is quite different from the real person. What one sees in the true mirror is much more lifelike. This feature of the true mirror will help people understand why others react.
That's Stuart. I should say we edited it live, so we told people to stop or start, so that was part of it. When they got
being new is, in fact, often understood as a combination of being different and being recently produced. We call a car a new car if this car is different from other cars and at the same time the latest, most recent model. But to be new is by no means the same as being different.
Okay, that's Kojo speaking there. He was kind of in a lead role in it. Okay, I'll go back to the walkthrough now. Okay, I'm going to... In the True Mirror Room, we showed this video, and that's what's on the memory stick. It's about 17 minutes long. We also showed supporting materials like the letter, which we had since blown up into a kind of A0 size print. I'm going to go and speed it up a bit through here. Actually, we'll go back to that. There is a mirror record that we made. There was a film, a kind of flickering film, which we see here in slow motion, which looks good in slow motion, which included everything that was on the microfiche. And next to that was the fiche itself, a small button that we had on the wall, and... the True Mirror itself, and actually here is Chris holding his phone, shooting this video in the True Mirror. If Chris could see himself, he would see how other people see him right now. And finally, on the wall behind all of this are two monitors showing that same video that I just showed you, an excerpt of. Now I want to go to the next, we're going to speed ahead to the next part, the next room. So that was rooms 1 and 2, and now we're entering the third room. The third room is around a project that we did starting in 2013 called The Last Shot Clock. It's primarily consisted of two matching electronic clocks, which you see here, and I'll stop and talk about just now. These are operating in slow motion, but they change about on the second through a repeating pattern that loops. It actually counts down from 15 to 0. Using a binary notation of big zeros and little zeros. Not very important, but it's a short repeating pattern. It's kind of just on the edge of legibility, perhaps. You can almost tell it's a pattern, then you get confused. Okay. Now I'm going to talk about that clock a little bit. Oops. Go back here. Okay, that clock was originally made as part of an invitation for the 2013 Venice Biennale. Specifically, we were asked to contribute to the Lithuanian Cypriot Pavilion. We're not Lithuanians or Cypriots. The curator was Raimundas Malašauskas, who is Lithuanian. Stuart and I started working together on a project in Cyprus with Raimundas. Raimundas also collaborated with us on the True Mirror project. Raimundas was the curator for both Lithuania and Cyprus, and he decided to join their two pavilions, pool the resources, and do it in a non-conventional manner. So he commandeered an existing gymnasium, a basketball gym in Venice, right next to the Arsenale, where the rest of the art exhibition, a big part of the art exhibition happens. And he used this gymnasium to install a series of works. All right, this video shows the gymnasium being used for basketball. It's a beautiful space of brutalist piece of architecture hidden back right next to the Arsenale in Venice, a good location. It's also actively in use. Because it had two sides, then Raimundas thought that was quite a nice immediate departure point for his Cyprus and Lithuania pavilion. When he described this to us, we immediately saw the scoreboards and thought, wow, that's really, it'd be great to do something with the scoreboards. And what we proposed to do for those scoreboards is turn them into signs for the exhibition, like to do the graphic design using the scoreboards, essentially. The name of the show was O-O, or big O, little O. And in fact, he called the Lithuania side big O, little O, and he called the Cyprus side little O, big O, depending on your point of view. So we thought it'd be very nice to have these scoreboards announce the name OO. And so we worked with the scoreboard's manufacturer north of Venice to produce custom software and burn a chip, these chips, which were inserted into those scoreboards to make the clock function display differently. Okay. We designed a very simple pattern, that pattern of the big O's and little O's you saw just a moment ago. When we arrived in Venice to install these things, the opening was happening that day, or rather the like curator's tour. An important thing was happening at 1 p.m., I believe. And we arrived just slightly before that. We were disheveled. We lost our luggage en route. It was not a good scene. And the chips had just shown up, so nobody had been able to install them in the meantime. But we got there, and the curator, or the producer, rather, the production person on this, said, get to work immediately and put in those chips and get it working. So we did. We opened up the scoreboard controller, which is this thing you see here, inserted the chips with a little bit of help. Whoops. And plugged it in, turned it on, and this is what we saw. Which looks kind of great, but it was not what we meant to do. And we thought, wow, that looks really great. Maybe we should just go with that. But it wasn't what we wanted to do, and it didn't work this time. That was just moments, or, you know, well, not very long, an hour and a half before the walkthrough. And so the production person thought this was just the worst thing that could ever happen, and she proceeded to call around in Venice and says, see if anybody else has a scoreboard controller for a basketball giant scoreboard. Seemed pretty unlikely, and nobody did, and this was going on. It wasn't working very well. We were talking to the scoreboards manufacturers on the phone, and right at the last minute, all of a sudden, the person who runs the gym said, oh, I think I have another controller back in storage. It doesn't work anymore, but we could try that. So he pulled that out. We put the chips in that. And amazingly, good story, it worked. It worked perfectly. We're very, very happy. And this is what it looked like once it started working. This is the scoreboard on the ground before they raised it up. So that was working and installed, and there were scoreboards on either end playing the same repeating pattern, and there were artworks installed, like this is a work of walls that had existed in other exhibitions. There's another work, which is the pine straw on the ground. There's another work, which is a laser that goes up to the ceiling here, and a painting hanging on the wall, anyway, and a dance performance. It was quite a specific atmosphere in here, and in fact, the pavilion ended up winning some award at Venice that year, which was great. I'm going to continue on through this room a little bit. We'll zoom around to the side. So I described they're the main works in the room, and then they're kind of supporting works. All the works are numbered on the walls, and that's because we think of them more as like they're not really directly artworks. They're usually like pieces of design, like juxtaposed in this context. So it seemed nice to number them, and then we get very thorough captions for the works. I'm going to zoom forward a little bit to the next work on the wall. We put the chips up on the wall, for example, the chips that were used for the reprogramming the scoreboards. And then the thing that's next to it is another piece, which I'm going to show here. And I'll show this in slow motion. The piece next to it is called Watch Wioscan 0.5 Hertz. It doesn't actually play this slow, but it plays kind of slow. It's a commercial product that Stuart and I designed, and I'll show that now. Okay. So Watch Wioscan is based on the ordinary Casio F91 watch, which is like a $10 digital watch, and we were invited by Eric Weissokan, who's an artist and has a production company called Halmos in New York, to come up with a scheme for how to change the digital display on that watch, given its limits of it uses those segments and certain technical limits, to come up with an idea about a different way of displaying time on it. He was going to ask a series of artists to do this and then release these as commercial products, manufacture them and release them. We were the first who he asked. we had an idea for the display of the watch, which was something like that slow motion video, which is basically just to slow down the display. So that when a digital watch draws anyway, it doesn't all draw at the same time. So if we just exaggerated how slowly it drew, we could make it like just barely legible. So that was the idea. We made a software mock-up of it and gave it to Eric, who programmed it and had new circuit boards manufactured and then inserted into the watches. Actually, and this is a video of how that watch works. I'm also wearing it right now. So it works just like this. That's it, real time. And you can change how fast the display works, and the instructions that are provided with the watch, kind of overly verbose instruction manual, say to set that display speed at the limits of your perception. Like it should just be just barely visible to you. So the longer you wear it, the more you start to be able to read it. I mean, probably many of you can read it right now, I find. But you can set it faster or slower. It was important to us that this was a commercial product. So this was sold in stores and circulated in that manner. Even though it doesn't work like there are plenty of clever watches out there, so I suppose it's like just any of those. But so we worked very carefully on the advertising that went with this thing. So we commissioned this absurd photograph of the watch on a piece of quartz made by Jason Fulford, a regular collaborator, photographer of our photographer, a close friend. We wrote the copy that went with it, which looks like an advertisement from 1983. It says, "Time is like that, both point and duration," and then goes on and describes the project a bit more. Okay, we'll turn back to the exhibition. This is a printed postcard. It's we called it Watch Scan 1400 DPI. This was made as a publicity image, promotional image for an exhibition in New York at Apex Art, which was about time in some broad manner. This image is just the my watch, my like Omega, like eBayed watch, which I like a lot. We put this watch on a scanner and scanned it at 1400 DPI, a very high resolution, which means what happens then is the scanner bar moves very slowly over it. In fact, it moves slower than the second hand. So what happens then in that scan is that the image, the second hand is moving slower than that image making thing, and so what happens is the second hand appears to bend. This is a completely unaltered Photoshop file. And as you zoom in on it, even the various colors come in at different times on this image. This, we made this a direct connection to the WyoScan watch, which we had just done at the time. I think a lot of our projects, we try to take one idea and just do it again. But sometimes the situation changes, and so then the work changes. And this was just a postcard made like 500 copies and sent around as a promotional image, but something we quite like. Going to continue through the show. Speed up. Okay, there's the clock on the other end of the same room. Okay, now I'm going to let this play stop. In that room, we also had two, at either end, under the clocks, these music stands and a piece of printed matter, a postcard, silkscreen thing, which says this that we see here, which says, "Dexter Sinister will perform the last shot clock in this space Saturday, September, 3rd of October, 7 p.m. This was the night after the exhibition opening. Stuart and I did a performance in this space as a way to kind of activate the... Well, anyway, that's what we did. I want to describe the performance a little bit now. For the performance, we had chairs set up on either side of this main hall, and Stuart and I stood at the podiums at either end and recited a long poem and played some music, the poem, something that we wrote. I'll describe that now. So that shot clock in Venice, we always had the idea that scoreboard, like the microfiche, it could be a score for a performance after the fact. Like we thought, oh, this would be a good way to make a performance. So we thought that scoreboard somehow would be a kind of, like a metronome or something like that for a performance. We were invited a year later to do something at the Contemporary Art Center in Vilnius in Lithuania. And we thought this was a perfect time to convene this performance. It was about a year after, almost exactly a year after the party we'd missed in Venice. And in fact, we thought what we should do in Vilnius was do this performance. And the point of the performance was going to be group time travel to go back to this party that we missed. And we were dead serious about this. And we figured it was, we did it on the summer solstice. We insisted that it have to happen on the summer solstice and that the performance would peak at midnight, so we didn't start till 11. We had plenty of alcohol beforehand, or the guests did, and we were more straight. Well, the first thing we made for that was to take the logic of those two clocks and have them remade as digital LED clocks in Lithuania. And those are the things that are on view in here's one playing around. This is the setup at the Contemporary Art Center in Vilnius. There happened to be a courtyard up on the first floor, up on the, you know, the not the ground floor, but the first floor, which was an interior courtyard, and we thought was a perfect space to do our performance. So we had the clocks mounted at either end of this courtyard, and then in the surrounding area, we made an exhibition, which were mostly other people's works and some of our works, but which had something to do with time travel or time or alternate ways of thinking about time. We never actually said time travel exactly, but we said, alternate conceptions of time. We mounted the clocks. Here's one of them ticking away on either end of this courtyard space. These sculptures were not anything we made. These were made by a Lithuanian artist, and they appeared in the meantime between when we proposed this project and when we did it, and actually we thought they worked well, and we had no choice. They're giant and not going anywhere. So we performed around them, and that worked. That ended up working. Here you see some of the works on the walls, so some similar things to what were in Munich. Here's an image from the performance of me standing in front of a lectern, and Stuart and I were speaking a poem back and forth that we had written, which was meant to, and then in between stanzas we were playing pieces of music which had strange time signatures or various ways of keeping track of time. I'm going to play. People attended the performance, and the last piece was a piece of music which was made with tuning forks and followed exactly the rhythm of those clocks. And it lasted for about 16 minutes, and the idea was this is when the time travel moment was going to happen. This is when we were going to get back to the party, and I think we did, actually. I'm going to play a little excerpt of that, and here are some people. Actually, here is, on the left, is Francesca, who is married to Stuart, who was figured earlier. Sake of time, I keep on moving. We're almost to the last room now. Okay. So what we liked about doing the performance in there is it seemed to leave some sort of residue in this space, at least imagined residue for anybody who was there, which, you know, is not that large of a crowd, but they're in Munich, so at least they can imagine what was there before. Okay, we can go into the back room. So there's one final room, which is here. Moving into that room. This room had a project contained within it called Letter and Spirit. I want to talk about two parts of that project next. So as you move in, you see on the wall a poster on the left there, and that poster announces the screening of Letter and Spirit. That poster is something that Stuart and I also made. Traditional piece of graphic design. It's a poster. The poster which announces a screening of this animation called Letter and Spirit. The image on the poster is taken from an existing painting poster we happen to see. This guy sitting on a sofa smoking a cigar. But somebody suggested that it looked more like he was holding a laptop. And we thought, he's imagining, like if you imagine a caption for it, he's saying, best email ever. Leaning back, congratulating himself, smoking the cigar. And this cracked, we laughed about this for a long time. We saw this at a poster festival in Chaumont in France, at a kind of graphic design exhibition that happens every year there around posters. So we decided, oh, it'd be really great to make that poster a kind of poster for our video, Letter in Spirit, which we had also shown there in Chaumont. We left the bottom space blank, which you see here, and every time we show this video, which has been a few times at this point, we have that silk screen with the location and the place where we're showing it, and then hang that in the exhibition. So it's not a very useful poster because it announces the thing that's already there, but that's okay. In Chaumont, in France, first time we did it, we had it also hung around the city, which was nice. So here it is, announcing Letter in Spirit. And to our shock, this is not us, we didn't do this, somebody graffitied that on it, like a little Apple logo. I actually don't know anything about this. The curator sent this to us, and he claims it was completely, I don't know what the story is, but anyway, that's what the image is. Maybe somebody else saw it on his laptop, heard the laptop. It says on the poster, it says, Dexter Sinister presents Letter in Spirit, a program that runs a script. And this is typical of a lot of the projects I've shared, a lot of things that we do. Like, this is using the mechanisms of graphic design, like a poster, and announcing an event that's going to happen. But in this case, it's our event. So we're kind of using it to announce something that we've made. So I'm not sure what that adds up to, but that's the case. Now I want to show a little bit of that, of what the video is, the Letter in Spirit video. So in this back room, as you turn around from the poster, you see projected on the wall an animation. And that animation, actually I'm going to speed this up a bit too. Okay, that animation, here it is playing very slowly. It's mostly type. It's a type that we designed. And what it's telling is the story of its own development. And also, it's about the history of typography in some broader way as well. So I want to tell you a little bit about this project now, and then that's it. So the typeface that was being shown there in Letter in Spirit is based on a kind of rambling typeface design project that Stuart and I have done beginning about 5 years ago. That project is based on an older computer, early digital font design project called Metafont, which was made by Donald Knuth, who's a computer scientist, taught at Stanford, developed an early digital typesetting program called Tech, which is still used in typesetting, like underneath contemporary typesetting programs, and another program called Metafont, which is used to design the shapes of letters, but it works in a way that's different than the way that letters are typically designed on a computer. So Metafont uses a model of a kind of something more like handwriting to describe the basic shapes of letters, and then you pick up, in the software, you pick up a pen and trace over the shapes of those letters, and the letters totally change. So it's like calligraphy, where you have some basic shape of an A, but if you have a different pen, the A is going to look very different. And this is different than how type usually works on software, which is you design exactly what it looks like, and that's what it looks like. So we are drawn to this idea about type that could have an essential form, but always be different in every situation. So we ended up making, but Metafont didn't run successfully on today's computer. So we embarked on a project which took about 6 months, to make Metafont work on a contemporary computer and work with laser printers that work in 2009 at this point, et cetera. We eventually did that, and the thing we made was basically no different than Metafont. It just worked now the right way. We gave it a new name, however. We called it Meta, the Difference Between the Two Font. So instead of Metafont, Meta, the Difference Between the Two Font. It's a great name, right? Very catchy. It's actually borrowed from a quote that we read of David Foster Wallace, who was asked about his writing, and an editor asked him whether it was... David Foster Wallace wrote maybe best-known novel called Infinite Jest, and this was in a profile in The New Yorker shortly after he passed away. David Foster Wallace was asked if his work was either metafiction, like fiction about fiction, or was it realism? And he said, well, you know what? It's not either one. It's not either realism, nor is it metafiction. If anything, it's meta, the difference between the two. We had no idea what that meant. You know, he tried to figure it out, like, what would that mean? Like, I can imagine halfway between metafiction and realism, but I can't imagine what then taking that up another level like meta. No idea what that means, but it seemed nice to think about. And since we had made this font, which is really no different than the first one, but just works now, we decided to call it Meta, the difference between the two font. And here is one version of that. This is the same typeface, different pen, same typeface, different pen and parameters, like different settings. This has a curliness setting. Same type, a different slant, same type, different pen. So after we made that first version, we thought then it would be interesting to add one other parameter to the thing that already existed since 1979. So as it existed right now, you could imagine the things that change the shape of the letter as forming a kind of three-dimensional cube. So with weight on one axis, so thicker or thinner letter, superness, which has to do with the roundness of the O and the other letters, slant, which is just forward or backward slanting, and then pen is the fourth parameter. That doesn't fit into a three-dimensional cube. So we imagine pen just changes over time. So we imagine it's a kind of like three-dimensional cube, and you have this point moving through it constantly, changing what the pen is, and it's a constantly changing, always evolving typeface. This was the idea, and we ended up making a computer program that realized that idea, which we called, then we added a couple more letters onto this font. Here it is running. It's called Meta, the difference between the two font 4D. It's a version of this which is constantly changing, so it only exists on a screen. We used that typeface first in an exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art called Ecstatic Alphabets, which is about artists using typography in some ways. This is a flat screen on the wall that used the Meta, the difference between the two font 4D, in order to advertise a publication, which is available in the bookstore, which is the catalog for the exhibition. This thing on the wall we called Trailer for an Exhibition Catalog. It was like brief descriptions of the things that are in the catalog. This is the catalog, and it also happens to be the third issue of the journal that Stuart and I and a third person, Angie Kiefer, a writer and artist, edit together. This one functioned as the catalog for the exhibition. Here you see MoMA is on the cover. In that catalog, we also published a piece of writing which described how we got to making that typeface, and that piece of writing was called Letter and Spirit. The animation, which was in the wall on the wall, which I'll show you a small excerpt of, was then an idea to take that longer essay and turn it into an animation that would tell the story of the font, using the font to tell its own story. You follow? I want to play the beginning of that, of Letter and Spirit. I'll pause it right there. It goes on to go into great detail around the typeface. And the last, now we'll exit the exhibition. And we're just about to the end here. We'll exit the exhibition quickly, as people tend to do. So here, going back out the door, out the front door, past the works. You know what those are now. There's the clock running faster than it usually does. And back down the stairs. Back down the stairs. Turns out there are two asterisks. I wasn't completely forthcoming at the beginning. There are two asterisks, one in English and one in German. The English one's at the bottom of the stairs. They greet you here. So, the last thing I want to just talk about is that asterisk. Just describe its development quickly, and then we are finished. The asterisk that played is based on that Meta, the difference between the two font 4D, and I'm going to play a little excerpt of that. So it's a glyph from that typeface, which we then decided it would be nice if it became a voice.
Hello everyone. My name is Meta, the difference between the two font 4D asterisk. It is nice to meet you.
Okay. The voice that we used in this asterisk is the voice of a Scottish curator named Isla Lever-Yap. Isla is the voice we used in Identity. Isla is the voice we used in a number of projects over the years. Here is
an octopus in plan view. Part 1. The etymology of the word
octopus. When she's not an asterisk.
Octopus. Noun. A mollusk with 8 sucker-bearing arms, a soft sack-like body, strong beak-like jaws, and no internal shell. A taxonomic genus within the family Octopodidae. Origin Greek, from octo, meaning 8.
Isla has a voice that seemed to us legible, and since we had used her in many projects, we began to think of that as a kind of corollary to this typeface, and so we had an idea to merge the two of them together. The text she was reading is called An Octopus in Plan View, and it's written by Angie Kiefer, who I mentioned. Stuart and I do the serving library, all three of us together, equally. That's our project. So this is the first issue of the Bulletins of the Serving Library, and in it we published an essay by Angie. Sometimes we write in this thing also. Her essay was called An Octopus in Plan View, and cleverly we decided that was an asterisk. This was before our little interest in asterisks, but anyway, it was where the asterisk came from. What you heard Isla reading was the text that Angie wrote, which we did for another project I won't describe now. For when we had the idea to make a software version of Isla's voice, we thought, oh, it'd be great. We wouldn't have to bug her every time we need to have something read, which is not that often, but enough that we thought it'd be nice to be able to do it ourselves, and strange and whatever. Turns out there's a voice company that we had been put in contact with based in Edinburgh in Scotland who has a piece of software that will take your voice, chop it up into its constituent like phonemes, the little root bits of language, and then sequence those together to make a computer voice. You go into a recording studio and you read this funny script, which says things like, you need a long-term strategy in football. All 4 have appealed. Best wishes from New York. Europe is growing slower. He is in great shape now. I thought it was superb. Anyway, it's great. It's like poetry. You read this, and the software takes these sentences, chops them up, assembles them into a computer voice, which we're going to hear now. This is the last thing we'll hear Isla speak.
At 7 p.m. November the 11th, 2015 at Museo Tamayo, Mexico City, David Reinfert will present a public lecture called, I'll Be Your Interface. Asterisk. David will present work that exists in the infra-thin space between its content and its audience. These will be gathered under the umbrella heading of interfaces. The talk is presented by Second Thoughts, a program of lectures, workshops, and panel discussions focused on artistic practices that use graphic design as a medium for critical experimentation and reflection. This project was initiated by Federico Perez Villoro and developed with Fundación Alumnos 47.
Okay, that is the end. Thank you.